How do you solve a problem like the Donald? That's the question facing governments around the world. Countries like Iran, North Korea, and Sudan suspect President Trump may deliberately provoke them. His treatment of Mexico, officially a US ally, only adds to that concern. A visit by new US Defense Secretary James Mattis to South Korea and Japan could prompt early retaliation, while others may seek to exploit a president they may regard as impulsive, inexperienced, and self-important.
Trump already argued with Australia's Prime Minister about resettlement agreements. He held hands with UK Prime Minister Theresa May, who had gone to forge a special relationship. It's reported Saudi Arabia's King Salman did not raise the travel ban when speaking to Trump, while Pakistan is also keeping quiet. Germany's Angela Merkel is one of the few to publicly oppose Trump's ban on Syrian refugees, but even she did not hit back at criticisms of her. Vladimir Putin from Russia, Benjamin Netanyahu from Israel, and Xi Jinping from China are also watching and waiting. However, there have been huge public protests globally as valid visa holders and legal residents are caught up in confusion over the travel ban's legality, with Iran describing Trump's veto on Iranian travelers as a shameful act. Many suspect Trump wants a reason to dump the 2015 nuclear deal with Iran. Iran's Foreign Minister Javad Zarif suggested the US complaint at the UN about an allegedly illegal Iranian ballistic missile test was a politically motivated sign of things to come.
Is President Trump specifically targeting Muslims? And why are millions expressing concern about the new president's actions? Simple but important questions. We began by asking the public internationally how they feel about Donald Trump's decision to ban citizens and dual nationals in seven Muslim-majority countries from entering the US. Here's what they said.
The truth is that it is outrageous. United States has always been known as an immigration country. Immigrants are its history. Its development has been based on the immigrants' work from countries all over the world, and that is what enriches it. Discriminate them just for the country they come from, it is completely absurd. It is annoying. It is outrageous from all points of view.
Trump's policies are not entirely against the Muslims. Behind them, there is a policy which is focused on the more you generate hatred against a group of people, the easier it is to impose measures that take away their liberties and freedom.
It is not fair that the leader of such an important country that has an impact worldwide blames most of the people because of a minority. This is the 21st century and we still have so many differences when actually they should not exist because, after all, we are all human beings without regard to our nationality.
I think that he is aware of the Republicans' and Democrats' policy. The new type of policy does not seem to me very noteworthy because Obama also did it with so many countries like Iran.
I don't really know how I feel. I feel like we're kind of, America is a melting pot. And so I think if people are willing to pay taxes and work and, you know, have a dual citizenship, that they should be allowed to enter as long as they're contributing.
Well, I take two positions. One is based on the values of America. We just don't do that. We've always welcomed refugees. And we've welcomed, that's who we are. And then on the legal grounds, the executive order doesn't fulfill any of the requirements of the Constitution.
I think it's the opposite of everything we're supposed to stand for in this country.
It feels really unconstitutional in America. Originally was a home of immigrants, and I know my ancestors came over here from Europe and we were welcomed, or at least we were escaping religious discrimination in some places, and it just doesn't feel American, I guess.
It really is outrageous. It's outrageous in many different ways. One is that none of people from these seven countries have ever committed any act of terrorism in the United States. while others have and have not been banned. And secondly, it really doesn't, you know, to go for people of a whole nation, even if there was one or two rotten apples in that nation, it really is outrageous because it doesn't address the issue. And if anything, it turns the whole issue into racism, nationalism, and sort of basically going for the whole section of community. When there's really not there any reason or indeed any justification.
Well, Donald Trump's what's dubbed as the Muslim ban leaves me extremely concerned and worried, not just because I'm a Muslim, but more so because of what it means for the international community and the world as a whole. I think it would be wrong for us to take our freedoms and our liberties for granted. The world moves in cycles, and I think there is this fear that we are moving from one cycle to another political cycle of extreme intolerance, extreme bigotry, and fascistic elements and Nazism. So that's the fear, and I think that's something we should all be worried about, not just because we are Muslims as Muslims, but because it undermines the very fabric of Western civilization as well. So these are grave concerns.
When George W. Bush started his so-called war on terror, he stated Muslims were not the enemy and the fight was against international terrorism. Does the public think Trump's entry ban targets Muslims?
It's very hypocritical since Trump has relations with Persian Gulf sheikhs, but of course when there's money involved, nothing happens. But he does not want ordinary and poor people.
I think he made statements about it. He made absolute racist statements to those countries. I'm speechless. This is outrageous.
Terrorism has always been there, and we must fight against it. He says that the only Muslims are the ones who commit terrorism, and this seems unfair to me, and I think it's wrong.
You have to always be looking for an enemy, and in this case, the closest and more obvious enemies are the Muslims, just because of the bad perception of the Muslims relating to terrorism. If you say Muslim, you say terrorist. If a Colombian arrives at a European airport, he will be associated with drug trafficking.
I totally disagree with that characterization that he makes. I've had the benefit of living abroad for about 20-25% of my life. In my current position, I have 130 international law students. About a fifth of them are Muslim. And I would never, ever make that characterization. I think most Americans would agree with my position.
I agree, and he said that multiple times in his speeches. He said the word Muslims. He doesn't say people from certain countries. He didn't say terrorists. He said Muslims.
I guess this administration definitely is presenting itself as a much more Islamophobic administration than George Bush's did.
Now, what is happening right across the world is, people trying to find scapegoats, you know. Look, is the Muslims who are doing that? Is Islam who is doing that? And they're actually deliberately diverting their attention away from the real politics, the fact that, you know, West has got a lot to do with actually creation of this thing. Daesh would not be existent if it wasn't the support of the West and so forth. And so really what we are getting from Trump, what I'm trying to say, is part of that process. And that process started at 9/11, and now we got Trump. And as a community, we need to decide, do we want to allow this to continue in the same direction, or are we going to stop this environment of hate, which has been fueling and making it legitimize having people like Trump being sort of elected and selected at the heads of government?
It is true that Donald Trump is more openly hostile to Muslims, and his policies are a lot more belligerent towards Muslims than, say, George W. Bush. But that said, I think it would be wrong to deny the fact that much of the vilification and animosity towards Muslims began even during the time of Bush, or before Bush, during the period of war on terror. So while we can denounce Trump, we should realize that much of the groundwork for the legitimization of hatred and belligerence and dehumanization of Muslims began under the era of George W. Bush. And Trump has basically ridden on that wave of hatred and animosity towards Bush, towards Muslims, which was planted during the time of George W. Bush. So this is not something new to Trump. This is something that's been going on systematically for the past nearly two decades, I would say, since the beginning of the war on terror under George W. Bush.
Many state leaders have been reluctant to criticize Trump for his apparent Muslim ban. How does the public feel about this?
I guess they lack courage. It is a matter of diplomacy. If it's not his country, he doesn't care. If they are not his people, he doesn't care. But I think we should exert pressure on him. I don't know, economic measures or whatever they have to do, because it is something that does not take place. This kind of discrimination should not happen.
USA is using their dominant position they have right now, but they will lose it in the future. If it's not in a couple of years, it'll be in 100 years. But it's obvious that he manipulates on how the countries must act. My country, Spain, and the European Union as well, should not give in to this.
In Europe, I noticed that the attitude against Trump's policies is more fearful.
Oh, I think that's a legitimate concern because he is a loose cannon and he doesn't really represent the normal America that we hope America would be. And his rhetorics and also his actions are very harmful for our allies and also for the causes that we're fighting over the globe.
If they're not following the law and the basis of the Constitution, then they should be speaking out against it. And they're just as bad as him. If you see something wrong, you need to speak up, and they're not.
I feel like the state leaders are putting their own fears of not getting reelected in office ahead of their own values and the values of the American people that they are representing.
Politicians find it difficult to find real solution, so it's easy just to blame a group of people who haven't got much power to fight back and blame them and create these divisions in the society. Now, this been not understood by many people, but unfortunately, Trump is not alone in trying to use this policy. There are many others in the political arenas who actually think that this is a very smart way of moving forward. That's why we see fascism is actually growing within the politics of today. We've got Le Pen possibility of coming to power. We have Gilders coming to possibly into power, and indeed many others. You know, we have seen the Brexit and so forth. They're all part of the same simplistic demonization of a group of people as others and blaming them for everything else. And unfortunately, the reason that they're not coming out against him or they're silenced because they're using the same policy and same politics. And this is actually what is very dangerous, because this demonization and the environment of hate is not just in the United States, but unfortunately is global.
Yeah, it is sad that some heads of state have openly supported the Muslim ban which Trump has imposed. It's sad that they've put their self-interest ahead of the rights of other human beings. And it's also telling that they've actually supported a policy which US judges have actually said is unconstitutional and discriminatory towards Muslims. So that is quite sad.
Some say handling Trump is about flattery, manipulation, and misleading him. Other conservative leaders, such as Viktor Orban in Hungary, have applauded Trump's America First nationalism and the end of multilateralism, possibly hoping for a political and economic payoff. Far-right European parties may also benefit. Marine Le Pen, the French Front National leader, could even seek a Trump endorsement.
Why are so many people around the world so worried about the words and actions of US President Trump? We asked them.
As I said, if the leaders do not do their job, then the people have to go to the streets and try to stop it. Although I do not know whether it will work or not, but people have to do the most they can against this injustice.
I think that it is the people who have to protest and say that they don't want all these kinds of things. We have fought hard through history to achieve equality and to have the same rights and the same opportunities around the world. And such a man like him is telling us that this is not going to happen. I think we have to be united and put pressure because we don't want this to happen.
I think they are necessary because if the people do these things, the politician will see themselves forced. Because at the end, it's another profession. I mean, the final purpose is to maintain a level of votes. But if there's a march in the street saying they're not going to vote for you, that is uncomfortable, isn't it?
As long as they are peaceful, meaning not reacting in the same way with a protest that destroys everything.
I think I personally go along with that majority. I think he can be very offensive. And that is actually one of my concerns of him, you know, being offensive to other people because he speaks without really thinking all of the time. And he's representing our entire country.
I think it's a mistake and I think it should be reversed because this is not what America stands for. Because I don't think that's a wise decision. And I think that affects a lot of people, innocent people from entering the country.
Well, he's using fear and anxiety to drive his policies. It's completely unnecessary. The way I look at it is our conditions today were no different than 2 weeks ago, 1 month ago, 6 months ago. So there's hysteria based on nothing. There's no proof. But that's been the problem of the administration since the get-go, is that there's no proof behind any of the purported facts that he's trying to present.
Because he's volatile and he is emotional, and you need to be level-headed as a leader, and you need to follow the law, and he's not following the law. And the consequences could mean America being such a, the United States being such a powerful country can wield consequences that affect the whole world.
I think people genuinely should be concerned, but also people should be genuinely concerned because this guy, on the first few weeks, has actually become a dictator. It's actually giving decrees every 5 minutes against not only, you know, against people around the world, against Americans, against the ideology that is accepted internationally. You know, he's actually becoming racist and fascist, and he's actually starting threatening people around the world. So really, we should be extremely concerned. But I would say that what we should be more concerned is not just one personality of Trump. We should be concerned that why we have gone down such a route which have created the environment where someone like Trump could actually become chosen and voted in to become president of the United States.
I think Trump is part of a much bigger global change. We have just come at the back of major changes that's taking place around the world. In the Middle East, we've had a pushback against democracy. We had a number of coups which undermined elected governments in the region. We had a number of wars within Europe. We've had the rise of popular right-wing nationalism. We've had Brexit, and also in France, we have right-wing governments. So Trump is really a part of this groundswell of hatred and animosity, which is really fueled by hatred, not just to the elites, but also towards Muslims by and large. And that's what's fueling a lot of this anger and hatred towards the other, towards the foreigner, and to have Trump come into this cocktail of divisions and hatred, which is taking place around the world, it just adds another layer of danger and hostility, and which really doesn't really bode well for the rest of the world.
In his first month as president, Trump already threatened other nations. Will Trump's presidency lead to war, and how will the world react if he takes America into another pointless conflict?
I do not think he will reach such a large scale. Well, I hope he won't.
At this point, I think United States is too powerful, and I sincerely hope that it does not happen.
Wars have been here throughout the history. Now we are deeply shocked, which is normal, because it's horrible. But there's always been wars. So if you ask me if there'll be a war or not, there are already wars.
He has the power to do so, but it would be terrible if he did it.
In the case of US governments, if there isn't any real conflict, they make one. Nowadays, wars exist because of the natural resources. So, well, they started with Syria, and Iran is the next one.
No one ever wants there to be a war. So I think that is a lot of Americans who did not vote for him, that is in the back of their minds, is that's a concern.
I think that's what we're all worried about here, is that, yes, it's a possibility. I hope it doesn't. But yes, I think that is a very scary possibility. And it will only make other countries hate us more. It's hard to have sympathy for a country that's constantly invading other people.
I wouldn't be surprised if there was another war under his presidency, because his approval ratings are already extremely low, and he's only been in office for a week. And a pattern, it seems to be with popular presidents in America, is to start a war because you don't take a man out of office if he started a war. You don't do that during wartime. So that would not be a surprise, I think.
From what we are seeing of Trump and his rhetoric, his warmongering and threatening the whole world, we need to be extremely worried, first of all, but also we need to hold the institutions in the United States accountable for this. You know, the courts, basically two houses, and indeed even the armed forces. Because if they allow Trump to get involved in a war which is going not only to destroy those countries, but destroys the whole of the international community, then they are responsible and they will be accountable for that. I think what we are seeing is very dangerous, but the only silver lining is that this guy is so outrageous that I think nobody will really take him seriously. And I hope I'm right to say and to think that people will not follow him into those wars, firstly. And secondly, I think these type of people, sometimes they're more of a hot air talk rather than action. And I hope that will be the case. Otherwise, we are really going to see very, very difficult time ahead of us in the next 4 years.
Well, I don't have a crystal ball. I don't know if Trump will start another war. I mean, I hope that he will surprise us all and tone down his rhetoric and not go into a war. But that said, wars are already taking place. US has instigated a number of wars over the last two decades, namely, of course, in the Middle East. But I will remain hopeful. But that said, I think, Trump has exposed some of the ugliness and the cancer within politics in the world at the moment. If we had someone like Obama again, then I think he would have covered up a lot of the cracks, a lot of the cancer and the poison in politics in America and in Europe as well. What Trump has done has actually showed the cancer that's within politics. And what I hope that will do is galvanize people around the world to not take things for granted and say, look, if we don't stand up, then our societies will be destroyed, our countries will be damaged, and we'll wake up one day and things will not be the same. So I think this has, in a sense, been a good thing. It's shown the cancer that's out there. And and I hope people will rise up as they are in undermining and pushing back against these fascistic elements that's arising in America and also within Europe.
US President Donald Trump has pledged to get tough with Iran, warning the Islamic Republic after its ballistic missile test that it was playing with fire and that all US options were on the table. This is typical of the comments the US President is making, which are worrying the world.
Donald Tusk, the European Council President, is so alarmed about what he calls the Trump threat that he issued an urgent call to European Union leaders. The Europeans are not panicking yet, but Tusk's message is plain. We need to talk about Donald. They know the questions, but so far, it seems no one has the answers.